controversies to the consensus of the hypertension. Hypertension is a topic, you know, how many number of times you listen to this, whoever speaks onto that, still we somehow get some new points in it, because it keeps changing, and it's one of the commonest problems what we face. Most of the patients, I'll come to the topic again, so you'll know the magnitude of the problem soon. Now, under these heads, I'm going to discuss this topic so that it will not be boring. Now, surprising figure is 30% of the Indian population are hypertensives. I mean, remarkably high figure. Contrary to what we used to think, it is 7 to 8% of the population, now it has gone up to 30% of the Indian population do suffer from hypertension. Still more worrying figures are, only 50% of them, they know that they are hypertensives. That is still worse, because this is one thing which doesn't produce symptoms. So by the time patient realizes, the damage is already done. What we call it is a silent killer. Now, another important thing in this context is, even after diagnosing hypertension, only very few, that is 20% of the patients, do get a proper treatment and proper control of the hypertension. This is also really worrisome figure. Now, I don't want to go into the details. We know it's one of the first times, it is 1700s, where Stephen Hale was the person who has first measured the blood pressure, though it is an invasive method. 150 years later, that is 1890, that is, we get this, whatever the modern BP apparatus, that is Rivarosic cuff with a sphygmomanometer, non-invasive method. But even this, let me tell you, we are not using properly. So it is, though it is very non-invasive, it is not being used in the way it should be used. That's why a lot of times, some of the hypertensives are missed, and some of the normal people are branded as hypertensives. Now, there are some strict guidelines of you first take the blood pressure, first time when you take a person, before you brand him as hypertensive. We are supposed to take average of 3 recordings, taken at an interval of 2 to 3 minutes. In a patient who is quiet, abstain from alcohol or smoking or coffee for at least 30 minutes in a quiet room. And measurement is done either in supine or sitting position, but that has to be mentioned clearly in which position you have taken, so that next time when you take it, you should take in the same position. Of course, the arm should be at the level of the heart. Now, what's the importance of all this? You see this. Now, these are the false readings which you get if you don't follow the rules. Supposing the person is not quiet, is not in a restful place, there could be an increase of the BP of around 12 to 15 millimeters, which a normal person, you can brand him as a hypertensive. Now, the remaining all follow, like if the cuff size is not proper, or if you, you know, try to lower the mercury at a faster speed. So all these things are fallacies which we should clearly understand, and however, you know, specialist or super specialist we are, we have to follow these guidelines, otherwise there could be false positives and false negatives in diagnosing hypertension. Ideally, you know, it looks this thing. Ideally, if you want to actually check a BP first time for a person, it takes around 10 minutes. How much time really we spend? You know, we just check the BP. Most of the time, assistant checks in a hurried and you know, a busy crowd. You can imagine how many we are branding as hypertensives. Now, everybody knows the classification of hypertension, a normal, pre-hypertensive, and stage 1 hypertension, and stage 2. Around way back, a few years back, it was just a grade 3 hypertension, grade 4 hypertension. Now, the classification is grade 1 and grade 2. Anything more than 160 is grade 2. Now, once you see the patient, you check the BP, then what do you do? Suppose you see the BP is normal with all the precautions which you have taken. If it is normal, then how frequently you have to check? You check once in a year or two. Now, if a person is prehypertensive is, you know, the figure. Prehypertensive is anywhere his systolic BP is 120 to 139 and diastolic BP is 80 to 89. In that situation, you check the BP, you give an advice about the lifestyle modification, which I'll come to that later, and then recheck the BP in a year. You can't miss him to the follow-up. Now, stage 1 hypertension, you confirm with one or two other readings before you start the treatment plan. Now, you heard about pre-hypertension. Systolic BP is more than 120 millimeters to 139, and diastolic is between 80 to 89. So it is slightly lesser than before you brand him as hypertensive. This is called pre-hypertension. The pre-hypertension is not a disease, but definitely it carries higher chance for the person to go into hypertensive stage. Now, what do we do with these pre-hypertensive patients? You see a BP which is slightly borderline, what you call, then you don't start drugs. You advise them about non-pharmacological methods, which I suppose all of you know. I'll run through that slide fast later. Now, another question is, can we predict a person, suppose you see in a clinic, whether he is going to become a hypertensive or not? His BP is normal. Now, can you say this man, in future, can you, like we have coronary artery disease, treadmill we do. Then we do treadmill, treadmill is positive. ECG is normal, treadmill is positive. We say this man is likely to have coronary artery disease. Like that hypertension, though the baseline BP is normal, can we predict future event that the person can be hypertensive or not? There are three indicators. One is if there's a strong family history, so this person is likely to go into hypertension subsequently. The other one is when we do treadmill, there is a rise in the blood pressure. If there is an inappropriate rise in the blood pressure, say it is going up to 200, 220 like that, for same exercise, what routinely other people do, then inappropriate rise of the BP during treadmill is an indicator that the person may go into hypertension in future. And the third one is ambulatory BP pressure monitoring when you do. Normally the BP should dip in the night during sleep. Systolic and diastolic should dip, should become maybe normal or less than normal. If there is no nocturnal dip in ambulatory BP monitoring, these are the patients who are likely to develop hypertension in future. The reason why you have to go through this exercise is these are the patients you have to target and prevent them to develop overt hypertension, advising them about salt restriction and lifestyle modification. Now, what about ambulatory BP monitoring? Ambulatory BP monitoring provides information on 24 hours averaging of the BP. See, normally when we check BP, BP could be high, but we want to know, and it fluctuates. One time it is 120, another time 160. It's erratically it is changing. You want to know whether what is the average. You know, is it most of the time it is on the higher side, or is it most of the time it is in the normal range? Then it is something like Holter monitoring of the ECG. It is something like Holter monitoring of the blood pressure. A cuff is tied, and then a small generator-like thing is there, which is kept with him. So you can program it every 15 minutes or 30 minutes. The BP can be taken through that. And it is automatically recorded inside. We analyze it at the end of 24 hours. So this will give his BP status throughout the day and also in the night. The ambulatory BP monitoring correlates more closely with the hypertension-related organ damage. This is very important. Because when you see a person, his BP could be around 140 by 90. So you don't know how to prognosticate this patient. But when you do ambulatory BP monitoring for this patient, if most of the time his BP is higher, then you know these are the people who are going to go for target organ damage. Now, when do you do? Is it that you do ambulatory BP monitoring for all the patients when you come to the clinic? There are specific indications, like if you see a borderline hypertension, BP is around 130, 140 systolic. Every time you record, it is like that. So you don't know whether you have to start the medical treatment or not. Though non-pharmacological methods you always try, but whether you try medicines or not, it depends upon whether to establish whether he is hypertensive or not, for which it is required. Then white coat hypertension. Most of the time in our clinics, the BP apparently is slightly higher for a person, but in other sense, when you go to his house, you check the BP, BP could be normal. So when you have an ambiguity, basically ambulatory BP monitoring is, when you have an ambiguity whether this person has hypertension or not, that is the place where it is really required. Not a person who is already established hypertensive. What are the limitations? Limitations are, it may cause discomfort because every 15 minutes or 20 minutes, it will be inflating the cuff, and it's more expensive, of course. Now, I want to introduce some few terminologies which probably most of you know. Isolated systolic hypertension. Systolic BP is more important cardiovascular risk in ages more than 50. Whereas, less than 50 years, it's the diastolic BP which is the determinant factor. If you see this graph, as the age advances, see the last panel. At the age of 80, if you take the population, they have more of systolic hypertension. But come to the other side of the graph, age less than 40, most of the time it is diastolic hypertension. So systolic hypertension is more a problem with the elderly. It has its own other problems, we'll come to that later. The prevalence of hypertension in age, advanced ages, is definitely higher. As with the age, the BP tends to go up. But if it is going out of the normal limit, then we branded him as hypertension. In old age, often it presents as systolic hypertension and more likely to present with comorbid conditions like diabetes and lung problems and other things. And elders are more susceptible to the adverse effect of the drugs. So isolated systolic hypertension in elderly is not an easy thing to treat. If you treat a little bit aggressive, they go into hypotension. And they go into hypotensive stroke sometimes. It's really a challenge. Some of the terms like hypertensive crisis and hypertensive emergencies and urgencies. Hypertensive urgencies is, there is no, BP is higher, maybe it could be still 190, but there is no target organ damage or impending target organ damage. Whereas hypertensive emergencies are, the BP is high and there is an impending target organ damage. Could be temporary or permanent. Like, hypertensive encephalopathy, acute left ventricular failures with pulmonary edema. Say person with BP is 200, he goes into pulmonary edema, pink frothy sputum and almost going to hypoxia. So this is an emergency, like dissecting aneurysm of the aorta. These are the hypertensive emergencies where you have to reduce the BP at a war basis. Whereas hypertensive urgencies, we have time. Don't reduce the BP drastically. Sometimes it is deleterious. Now, this concept everybody knows, what is the primary hypertension, what is secondary hypertension. See, the primary hypertension constitutes more than 90%. Even one thing which you have to remember, suppose you say a person at 20 years of age, now he is hypertensive. So we think the secondary hypertension causes are more for him. But even at the age of 20, primary hypertension is the commonest. Even at the age also, primary hypertension is the commonest. But the percentage of secondary hypertension is more than what you see at the older age. Now, these are some of the common causes of secondary hypertension. Now, there are a lot of causes, any book gives that. Now, there are some clues when you are examining in your clinic a patient. There are some clues which will say that this person may have a secondary hypertension. The reason why you want to unmask the cause of secondary hypertension is they are treatable. Whereas primary hypertension is you give only antihypertensive drugs. In secondary hypertension, you have to treat the cause also, like coarctation of aorta, pheochromocytoma, or renal disease, or something like that. Now, what are the clues you get to say that the person has secondary hypertension if the onset of hypertension is less than 30 years or more than 50 years? Or if there's a sudden onset, or severe hypertension, you see, not responding to the treatment, then really you have to look into whether there is a treatable cause, secondary hypertension. And morbid obesity now this is entity is very much implicated in most of the diseases like sleep apnea syndrome. It's implicated in coronary artery disease, implicated in hypertension, in all the diseases. If the person has pallor, edema, and other signs of renal disease, or bruise, if you find anywhere, like it could be coarctation or aorta arteritis, or truncal obesity, or signs of any Cushing's. Obvious signs we should not miss when you examine the patient. Just saying that he's hypertensive is not enough. We have to know, apparently there is no cause for the secondary hypertension. That's what you have to establish. Now, these are some of the screening things, simple screening things like, urine examination, blood examination. Very, very simple tests can unmask the cause of secondary hypertension in 90% of the cases. It is not that you have to go through a battery of tests in a hypertensive patient. We always say a good urine examination, good routine blood examination like renal functions, hemoglobin, and an ultrasound. Most of the time, the diagnosis, if it is a secondary hypertension, you'll know the cause, most of the times. Now, what are the management guidelines for hypertension? Patient evaluation and treatment, of course. Now, what are the objectives of evaluation of the patient evaluation? To assess lifestyle, you have to see what is his lifestyle. Because unless you know the lifestyle of the patient, then your drug treatment will not be complete. Suppose in a business executive who is going around from place to place 24 hours, maybe 20 hours a day he works. However much you give the drugs, probably the BP will not be under control unless you suggest him they should be a lifestyle modification. At this point, I just want to say, most of the time we rely on the drugs to control hypertension. Most of the drugs, what we use for hypertension, like ACE inhibitors or ARBs or something, they're moderately potent, mild to moderate. Don't expect miracles out of them. Suppose somebody's BP is 180 by 100, you give a tablet, you know, within a couple of weeks, the BP will come down to 140. No, they're mild to moderate. At the maximum, they may reduce 20 to 30 millimeters in an isolated, monotherapy. So if the BP is high, you have to attack from all the sides. In the sense, he has to change the lifestyle an aggressive lifestyle, if possible, of course. Sometimes it may not be possible, but wherever possible, a person has to change the lifestyle for the drugs to have good effect. Now, you have to assess the other cardiovascular. When you treat the patient of hypertension or evaluate the patient of hypertension, you have to evaluate other coronary risk factors like diabetes, cholesterol, and other things, because they have a bearing on the treatment. Now, possible causes of secondary hypertension with minimal investigations at a clinical level, and of course minimal investigation should be able to get. It is not that you do cardiosalicy and all the things for any patient who comes with hypertension. No, another thing specifically we have to look into is the target organ damage. Cardiovascular system, easy to screen, an ECG and echo probably will complete the cardiovascular workup. Renal functions like urea, creatinine, and albumin in the urine will clear up whatever the renal status is. Nervous system is most of the time it is clinical. There is nothing like you do a CT scan for everybody. And fundus examination is a must for every hypertensive patient. Sometimes, because of the lack of the time, we may miss that, but fundus is a very, very, very good tool to assess the severity of the hypertension, because his BP may be 140 by 90. But if you see the fundus, it could be, you know, exudates and hemorrhages showing already the changes of grade 3. Maybe temporarily his BP is low and you are totally misguided by one reading of the BP. So fundus examination, whenever possible, or maybe as a mandatory that you have to see in all hypertensive patients. Now, these are the effects of hypertension on the cardiovascular system, which I don't want to go into the details, and on the kidneys, nervous system, and the eyes. Now, what are the goals when you treat the hypertension? See, mind you, most of it is a repetition. Any textbook gives this. Anybody talks, he has to go through the same thing. But again and again, we go, because in this is one of the commonest diseases, probably when you sit in a clinic, more than 50% of the patients have hypertension. Now, control of blood pressure is not just the only goal. Though control of hypertension will decrease most of the complications of hypertensive effect, but it is not just control of hypertension alone. It is prevention of end organ damage. Somebody has already got renal disease. You have to choose a drug which can reverse partly at least the renal. So he has a left ventricular hypertrophy. You choose a drug which will decrease the left ventricular hypertrophy. You know, so prevention or reversal of the end organ damage. And of course, better quality of life you have to give. See, you can't give diuretics in a hot summer, a laborer who is working, though diuretics are one of the first line drugs. I mean, a person who works in the hot sun, you don't give him chlorothalidone, because he'll become extraordinarily weak. Already he sweats so much, he loses a lot of fluid. So it is better quality. Your drug may control his BP, but quality of life goes down. So you have to think of quality of life. Of course, this goes without saying is financial status. Don't prescribe costly medicines for a poor man. He will not take much time. He'll take 1 week and he'll stop. So you try to choose a drug which is meets his pocket. What I mean by better quality of life in from all the fronts. Now, any hypertensive program, don't jump to give only medicines. Even if it is severe hypertension, there should be non-pharmacological methods which have to be intensified if already patient is on, and then add drugs. So the first thing is non-pharmacological methods, which they don't cost much to the patient or to the society. So these are the simple methods. Weight reduction is, you can see the figure actually in the graph, just mere weight reduction to a moderate level will decrease the blood pressure of 20 millimeters. Which most of our drugs can do only that much. If you put him on losartan, you put him on etanolol, it cannot reduce more than 20 millimeters, which you can achieve just by weight reduction. Similarly, diet programs, decrease the salt, physical activity, ask them to work. But it's easier said. Nobody wants, even patients don't want this. They want only medicine. Nobody wants to change the lifestyle. You know, they say that's an enjoyment for them. But in the long run, maybe like the program, what the demonetization of the currency. In the long run, you have to think, though the lifestyle modification, you really, you know, difficult for them. No, who wants to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and go for a walk? They want to sleep till 9 o'clock, get up somehow hurriedly, then go for the work. That's when the BP already starts, you know, right? In the morning itself, the BP starts. So people don't want, they want to keep awake till the late night, 3 o'clock, you know, seeing movies. That's the reason why the problem hypertension, I remember around 25, 30 years back, the incidence of hypertension was 7%. Our preventive social medicine books, Park and Park, used to give 7%. Phenomenally increased, 30% in Indian scenario. This is because we have changed our lifestyle. Nobody sleeps before 11 o'clock. You just find out any house, anybody sleeps before 11 o'clock? No. It's 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 3, throughout the night sometimes, and morning you will sleep. So if this is the lifestyle, you are distorting your system entirely. Distorting the system, I'm not saying only hypertension. It can cause diabetes also because of the overstress. You know, it can cause a hell of a lot of problems. So lifestyle modification is something which really we have to insist in every patient who comes. So in our clinic, it's a mandatory thing. If I see a patient and the attender comes with who is obese, we always advise him. You know, cut down. I mean, it's as a part of our social responsibility. We tell them, we always take the BP of the attendant if we have time or something like that. We have some suspicion. Point is, it is simple methods can make, you see the graph, the figure, 5 to 10 millimeters of mercury it can reduce by weight reduction, what we are achieving with medicines and adding their side effects and other things. You know, this something which everybody should insist. If we are busy in the clinic, you are not able to spend time, put a, you know, class, I mean some clerk or somebody who can give them a chart, what is the diet they have to take, and what are the advices, printed form, and one or two words, if you say that carries weightage, you know, that for the person to follow, it will be easy. You know? And motivation will be there when a doctor says. One or two words you say, and then give the paper, and some clerk or somebody can explain. Because this is equally important as prescribing the medicine. That is all I want to emphasize. Alcohol in moderate consumption. This is something people come to as patients. Somehow they read in internet and Google or something. They said, sir, can I take alcohol? Alcohol, can I start? He's very eagerly, he will ask, you know, expectantly. The dictum is, if somebody is already taking alcohol and he limits for 2 packs a day, that is 60 ml, you need not have to ask him to stop alcohol because it has some good effects, definitely. But you don't encourage starting alcohol. That is all. No, you can't say everybody should drink alcohol every day. No, that's one thing. Because some patients do ask this question. Sir, I have read in the internet, alcohol is good for health. Remaining good habits, he doesn't want to follow. Only alcohol he wants to follow. So, but then you have to tell him that better not to start. Because that's an addictive drink. You never know each person how he is going to behave. A DASH diet. This word you must be knowing, DASH. Dietary approaches to stop hypertension. Somewhere in the books you come across this word, that's why I'm saying. Dietary approaches to stop hypertension. DASH diet. This is what is the thing. That is, consume a diet which is rich in fruits, vegetables, and the lesser side of the fats and salt. Now, we have a lot of guidelines for treatment of hypertension. JNC7, JNC8, American Heart Association, European Society of Cardiology. Like that, we have a lot. Indian guidelines also are there now. Now, we have a lot of guidelines. Something you have to follow. Generally, by far, the guidelines which are followed are JNC guidelines, JNC8, which is the latest one. That's what routinely followed all over the world, majority of the people. Most of the time, the guidelines are same, except that, you know, 5 millimeters this way or that way. Now, the most important thing, any hypertensive, if you see, first of all, you can't brand him unless the BP is very high, 200 or something. If the BP is on the borderline in your clinic, 150 by 90, don't brand him as hypertension. May not be hypertensive, then he'll become hypertensive if you brand him. So you really have to assure him, take BP at 2 or 3 occasions, establish that his BP is definitely high, then only you have to brand him as hypertensive. Then once you brand him hypertensive, there's an algorithm, which I'll come to that. Now these are the simple guidelines which are given in JNC. That is, persons over the age of 60, you should be slightly less strict with the BP control. The reason is, one of the things which can happen in elderly people is thickening of the arterial wall. So your BP cuff may not compress it completely. Spuriously, his BP may be around 10 to 15 millimeters more. That is the reason why the allowance more than 60 years, they give up to 150 by 90. Whereas less than 60 years, the cutoff limit is 140 by 90. Exceptions being, even if the person is more than 60, if he is a diabetic or if he has a chronic renal disease, and some cases of severe left ventricular hypertrophy, then the BP cutoff is 140 by 90. Otherwise, in general, it's 140 by 90. Only old people more than 60 years without any comorbid conditions, you can allow up to 150 by 90. Now, we have a lot of drugs for hypertension. I'll go through the principles only. It's impossible to go through the whole list of the hypertensive drugs. Now, we have angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, then receptor blockers, calcium channel blockers, beta blockers, and thiazide diuretics. Beta blockers used to be one of the first-line drugs in the previous recommendations. Now, beta blockers are no more the first-line drugs in any of the recommendations because they have not proved to be superior or they are found to be inferior in the outcomes like mortality, morbidity in the long run compared to any of these drugs. There could be an exceptions. Like if you see a myocardial infarction patient, anterior wall MI is a hypertensive, then definitely you give beta blocker. If there are other indications to give beta blockers, then you can give beta blockers as the first line. But otherwise, now beta blockers are, even in Indian guidelines, almost said that beta blockers should not be the first line of treatment. Now, there are some specific conditions, like if you take diabetes, if you take renal disease, like those are the cases where ACE inhibitors, or if they don't tolerate ACE inhibitors because of persistent cough, then receptor blockers like losartan or something you can use. This is the same thing which I've told. Yeah, in diabetics and chronic renal disease, the cutoff, irrespective of the age, is 140 by 90. The main objective of treatment is to attain to control the blood pressure. That's the main object. Which drug you give, which suits his financial status, that's all. Depending on all those factors, the prime goal is to control the hypertension. Because every 1 millimeter decrease in the blood pressure, systolic and diastolic, there's a significant decrease in the morbidity and mortality. So there is no debate about it. BP has to be reduced. The drug is your choice, which one, or the patient's choice, you know, his financial status. If the goal of BP is not reached within a month of treatment, increase the dose of the initial drug or add a second drug. This is important because we see in the clinic, we give a drug. See, his BP is 160 by 100. We put him on losartan or something. Then he comes after 1 week. Sir, in our place, they have seen, RMP doctor has seen, BP is still high, 160 by 90. No, you expect me to hike up the... you have to give, you know, at least they say 4 half-lives it has to go through till the maximum effect of the drug comes to the body. So you have to wait for around 3 to 4 weeks, unless it is severe hypertension. I'm saying 200 by 140 or something. There is no urgency in treating the hypertension. You know, but on the other hand, if you reduce it drastically, there's a problem of hypoperfusion strokes and all. Its main problem for us is to convince the patient. Now, what happens is, he will come second time after 1 week. Sir, still BP is 160. Now we are in a fix. If you don't reduce, he will not come to you at all after that. See, these are the problems which we face. So really we have to sit and educate that, you know, you give this and we have to wait for some time. Still, you know, the ignorance is so much. Sometimes to follow real guidelines is very difficult. Yeah, so you have to wait for 1 month. Unless there is an impending indication to hike up the dose very fast, like the BP is going up to 200 and all, you go slow, take 4 weeks. Then after 4 weeks, the BP is not controlled. Either you hike the dose, unless he develops complications, the side effects. See, when you increase the dose, there could be chances of side effects. So if the patient is developing side effects, then instead of increasing the dose, you add another drug. Okay. Yeah, and his BP has to be assessed. Assessed in the way it should be. That means in a quiet room and so on and so forth. The clinician should continue to assess the BP and adjust the treatment regime until the goal of BP is achieved. If the goal of BP cannot be reached with two drugs, then add the third drug. Now, still if it is not controlled, then maybe you have to spend to the specialist. But these are the simple things any physician can do. An MBBS doctor can treat the hypertension. But with the three drugs also, if the person is not getting controlled, then maybe we have to go into the details why it is not getting controlled and what is the best regime to control his BP. It is better to leave to the specialist. One important word is, do not use ACE inhibitors and ARBs together. This I am specifically saying is, this concept of combining ARBs and ACE inhibitors was there a couple of years back. People used to give ARBs and ACE inhibitors. But now the recommendation is, don't combine ACE inhibitors and ARBs because the side effects are going to be very high. Now, fixed dose combination, poly pills. As I already in the beginning of my talk, I was telling, most of these times, the patient won't come just with hypertension. He has a lot of other problems like increased lipids, diabetes, coronary artery disease. So the concept of poly pill is very good, especially you know, in terms of compliance and adherence to the treatment. This works really good. In our practice also, we see just one tablet and one B complex. That's the end of his prescription. Yeah, even Indian guidelines, Indian hypertension guidelines also say that the use of fixed dose combination should be encouraged to increase the, especially the compliance problem is for most of the time Indians. See, especially diseases like hypertension, which doesn't have any symptoms. Yeah. Yeah, there are the studies to see the efficacy of this combination therapy as poly pills, and the trials are on the way. Some small trials have come, but big trials are on the way to see the efficacy. The only problem with this is, see, you won't be able to adjust individually the doses of the drugs which you give in that. But all the, probably this is what happens in the HOPE-3 trial, if you see. If they are given antihypertensives alone, the advantage is not much. When they combine with rosuvastatin, I don't know what happened. The advantage was tremendous. So when you combine, probably it has some additive effect and the beneficial effect. And the doses are in the mild to moderate, so the side effect profile also is not much. Probably the time has to save with all these tips, trial and all, which is going to come. Now, the benefits of beta blockers has been questioned now, which was a first-line drug once, but it's no more a first-line drug. And because there are studies which are favoring this concept, they compared losartan with etanolol, and they found that previously beta blockers was panacea, but now it is kept behind. Now, if you want to use beta blockers, it's a vasodilator beta blockers, a certain nebivolol and all. Those are the drugs which you tend to use. If really you want to use beta blockers as the first line, that's the concept which is coming now. Now, when the cholesterol treatment was started, they were saying how much the cholesterol you have to reduce. Say, they said 250 is limit, then you say 200, 175, 150, 100, 70, like that. So they used to say lesser the better. But of course, there's a cutoff point, but lower. But hypertension, they were saying 140 by 90. Now, there are trials which are going on. Suppose you reduce still further, is there going to be a benefit for the patient? Instead of 140 by 90 cutoff, suppose you reduce to 120. Now, that's why the SPRING trial which has come, which has used chlorthalidone and other drugs. See, the concept is still lesser. Whatever is recommended 140 by 90, you are trying to reduce the BP still further and see whether it's going to be good or not. Now they found it gave a good results. See, the overall benefits of more intense BP lowering exceeds the potential harm. There are some harms, but still they say at the end, the conclusion is that you can reduce the BP to 120. Small problem here is how effective and how meticulous we are checking the BP. That's very, very important. Without doing that, you try to reduce the BP to the lowest. See, if the sprint is applied without attention to proper BP measurement, which the guidelines, which in the beginning of our slides we talked, a quiet room and taken three times, all this, substantial over-treatment can occur. And in the real life, when it goes out, his BP could be around 90 by 70. See, this is very, very important. Unless you have meticulous methods of checking his BP, you spend enough time, then only you have to embark on this type of aggressive lowering of the BP. Otherwise, better to stick on, as on today, they say it's better to stick on to 140 by 90. Of course, whenever there's a trial which is favoring, there's always a trial which also opposes that. The HOPE-3 trial says that if you do intense lowering of the blood pressure, it is not going to be useful. Sometimes it's harmful. Basically, the reason is the way the study is conducted. That's very, very important. Now, there's a concept, when do you give antihypertensives? Suppose once in a dose, you give antihypertensives. Do you have to give in the morning or in the evening? No, whatever the literature, small trials which are saying, and the pharmacokinetics when they have taken into account, they found if you give in the evening the antihypertensives, that's supposed to be very good, and it has some edge over giving in the morning. But a large mass-based trials have not been conducted so far. There are two trials which are going on. Probably they will answer. Now, what is that Indian guidelines are saying now? There are certain things. As what is the other people, the beta blockers are no more the first-line drugs. And when the blood pressure is high, by more, here is the point. See, if the blood pressure is more than 20 millimeters by 10 millimeters mercury above the normal, that is, say, somebody's BP is 160 by around 100 or 110, then most of the times he cannot be controlled with single drug. So very soon you may have to go for two drugs. Now, what is the conclusion at the end of it? Hypertension remains a condition of public health with an enormous proportion. 30% is a very high figure, especially when it is a silent killer. Methodology to measure accurate blood pressure should be given with due importance, as important as prescribing the drugs. Ambulatory BP pressure monitoring is a useful tool in certain subset of people. Now, aggressive lowering the BP as on today should be utilized in very, very few cases with full supervision. Otherwise, we should stick on to the routine standard guidelines of 140/90. As I said, in special circumstances, you can have a target goal still lesser than that. And the choice of the drugs for controlling BP should be individualized. I mean, there's nothing like one tablet for everybody. Yeah, evening dose of antihypertensives can be advised, because there's nothing that anybody can strongly say, but if you have to give one dose, it is preferred to give in the evening. That's what is the thing, though there is no strong recommendation for it. Thank you very much for the patient listening.